It is a sprint to the legislative finish line for senators as they debate Build Back Better, try to find some resolution to keep the government running before it runs out at the end of this week, and also raise the debt ceiling by mid-December. Delaware Senator Chris Coons joins us right now. Senator, welcome back to the National Desk. What a time to be alive.
Yeah, one of the real joys of serving in the Senate is telling my family, no, I'm not sure if I'm going to be home for Christmas this year.
Oh, man.
We've got our agenda the next couple of weeks. We are right now tussling over whether we will take up and pass the defense authorization bill. We should. We get this done every year, and I am pushing my Republican friends and colleagues to work with us to get amendments taken up and voted and to pass that important bill.
Senator, let's also talk about Build Back Better. I know you support it. Two of your Democratic colleagues in the Senate, Joe Manchin, Kyrsten Sinema, still not on board. Let's take a listen to what Senator Manchin had to say about it earlier this week.
Inflation is now more than transitory. We found out it's not transitory. And on top of that, you have this new strain of COVID. They're very much concerned about. No one knows what effect it's going to have, and you have inflation on top. So all these things give you cause to pause.
What's your thought, Senator Coons? Isn't that reason to pause, do you think?
Well, Jan, what I've been saying to Joe Manchin is, yes, families are feeling the pinch at the pump, at the grocery store. The other positive about where our economy is going is that wages are rising. What Build Back Better will do for your average working family is deal with the costs that keep them up at night, whether it's the cost of daycare or elder care, whether it's housing costs or pre-K, and in particular, reducing the price of prescription drugs. Build Back Better is a program that will invest in some of the key costs that make inflation challenging for your average working family. And as a bill that is paid for, I don't think it will significantly add to inflationary pressure in our economy.
Senator, I think some people can get behind some of what you said, but this bill is also a big part of it about clean energy. You didn't get the carbon tax, though. You didn't get the clean electricity standard that a lot of Democrats wanted, but there are still measures in there that has people in coal mining states like Manchin's concerned about their future. Should the burden of meeting emissions reduction targets fall disproportionately on the communities who have helped to keep the lights on for generations?
Well, we ought to be matching any additional burden with additional investment. We ought to make sure that we're providing for development, for new manufacturing jobs, for new clean energy jobs in exactly those states that would be impacted by a transition. Look, Jan, the transition to a cleaner energy economy globally is happening. And what I think we should be doing is proactively investing in new technologies, in new industries, and in the skills to be competitive in those new industries across our country, and linking arms with our closest allies, as we discussed at the Global Climate Conference in Glasgow, so that we are jointly imposing a polluter fee on countries like China that are trying to dump our market full of high carbon steel, for example, so that we can sustain a competitive manufacturing industry here in the United States.
Yeah, Senator, you mentioned globally here as well. What do you think about this, when Senator Manchin says he's for innovation, not elimination? He says even if coal was reduced to zero in the United States, thousands of carbon-polluting coal mines would still operate in China and a lot of other countries, because it's not North America climate, it is global climate.
Dan, that's exactly why a big part of Build Back Better is investing in next-generation technologies that will make fossil fuel plants, whether they're coal-fired or they're gas-fired or they're nuclear, in the developing world, potentially far less polluting. Joe Manchin's right. If we're going to deal with climate, we have to deal with it globally. And I think the way that American innovation can actually help address that issue is by showing a path forward for very large countries like India and China that are still building new coal-fired power plants. Former Secretary John Kerry, when he was at Glasgow, met with the leading Chinese representative on climate issues. I also had a chance to meet with him and to press them really hard to reduce their methane emissions, to stop building and financing new coal-fired power plants. That's a critical piece of our work in the years ahead. Otherwise, we're simply imposing new costs on our economy
right,
that competitor economies are not facing. That's one of the key reasons I'm pushing for a border tax that would actually impose additional costs on countries like China that want to export dirty products into the United States.
This also comes when the current state of the economy, as you mentioned before, A lot of Americans concerned about inflation. It rose 6.2% over the past 12 months, the largest hike we've seen in 30 years. Treasury Secretary Jerome Powell even said we needed to retire the word transitory. So if it's here to stay, Senator, what's the solution?
Well, Fed Chairman Jay Powell, with whom I spoke last week, made it clear that this is not something that's just going to go away in a month or two. That means the Fed may well need to change monetary policy. That would strike me as a wise step to take at this point. But that's distinguishable. That's different, Jan, from whether or not we should continue with an agenda that will reduce costs for working people, reducing the cost of daycare and pre-K and prescription drugs. That can help reduce inflationary pressures on the folks who are feeling it most sharply right now.
Let's talk about gas prices. The president did release 50 million barrels of oil from the Strategic Petroleum Reserve because of these out-of-control gas prices. Clearly, this is not the long-term fix. The president knows this. You know this. What's next? What legislation are you suggesting to help lower the cost of gas?
Well, I'm actually talking with Senator Manchin, who's chairman of the Energy Committee, about what he thinks might be the best path forward here. The United States is a major energy producer, and one of the challenges we face as we transition to a cleaner energy economy, both here in the United States and globally, is how to make sure that during that transition, we're relying on American-produced energy sources and not importing from overseas, particularly from Russia. We've got a significant strategic challenge, Jan, in Eastern Europe, because Russia has put 100,000 troops on the border of Ukraine. Russia is the major gas source for Western Europe. We're going to be voting, I think, today or tomorrow on an amendment that would put sharp sanctions on Russia if they invade Ukraine and try to take more of their territory and try and cut off gas supplies to Western Europe. We need to be looking at how our own domestic energy supplies of natural gas can be both a critical strategic resource and domestic resource.
And very quickly, Senator, midterms right around the corner. What'd you think about the election results and some of the elections around the country, specifically in Virginia, where Democrats in rural counties did even worse than they have in recent years? Are you concerned Democrats will pay the ultimate price at the ballot box?
Well, Jen, from election to election, what I tell my colleagues is your average American wants to know that what we're working on is what matters to them, that we're not all caught up in inside the Beltway fighting and focused on Twitter and BuzzFeed and that sort of thing, that we're actually working on the things that'll make their lives easier. So to the extent the election results in Virginia suggest that simply fighting over Trump and his legacy isn't compelling, that your average American wants to know that we're working to make their schools safer and stronger and help make sure their kids get educated right, that's a lesson I think all of us stand to learn.
Senator Chris Coons from the great state of Delaware, we appreciate you joining us this morning. And if I don't see you, I hope you have a Merry Christmas, because you will probably be working.
Probably will. Great to be on with you again.